Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship this morning. We're going to start things off with a song. This one is called Little Drummer Boy. Please sing along with us or dance around, whatever you'd like to do.
People of God, and welcome to the fourth Sunday of Advent. Welcome to Christmas week 2020. Thank you for your presence as we gather online in this holy season, and as we look forward to better days ahead with 2021 approaching. Whether you are taking part live or watching the recording later, please greet one another and make your presence known by making a comment on the Facebook page. We appreciate that very much. Few announcements as we begin today. We will be celebrating Holy Communion, so have some bread and wine or grape juice ready to go so you can participate when the time comes if you'd like to do that. A couple other things. You can see Thursday's e-news, but remember that today at 10 a.m., and when this service concludes, we'll be switching over to Zoom so that we can get together for our third Advent coffee hour. If you've missed the first two, that's okay. Please hop on today. The link is in your Thursday e-news. It's time to show others your First Lutheran Church ornament that we distributed. And we did distribute over 150 ornaments over the past several weeks. And you can show how you chose to decorate it and see how others in your church family decorated theirs as well. So please Zoom in at 10 a.m. after worship concludes this morning. Well, you know, it's no surprise, this Thursday is Christmas Eve. Our Christmas Eve worship service will go live on Facebook at 4 p.m. Keep in mind that you can watch it on video recording if you can't watch at 4 o'clock. Just click on the videos on this Facebook page anytime after the service ends. We wish you and your loved ones a merry and a safe Christmas as we hear once again this story of God with us, Emmanuel. Next Sunday, reminder about next Sunday, December 27th, we will only have one worship service next Sunday, and that's at 10 a.m. on Facebook Live. And just like Christmas Eve and all our worship services, you can watch the video recording at another time at your choosing, later in the day or later in the week. Just go to the videos section of our First Lutheran Church Facebook page. Well, it's good to be together. And again, thank you for your presence. As we begin this morning, we light the candles on our Advent wreath as it is the fourth Sunday of Advent. And we thank the Johnson family for leading us this morning.
Today is the fourth Sunday of Advent.
Angels keep appearing in Scripture after the Advent and Christmas stories. When Jesus spends 40 days on retreat in the wilderness praying, fasting, and being tempted by Satan, the angels come and minister to him, providing food and comfort. In stories of Easter resurrection, angels roll the stone away from Jesus' tomb and tell the disciples that he is alive again. In the book of Acts, imprisoned apostles who are arrested as criminals are visited by angels and set free so they can continue to share God's message of liberation and healing. Angels give comfort to the suffering, hope to the grieving, and liberation to the oppressed.
We light the fourth candle of our Advent wreath as a reminder of all the ways we are called to embody the good news of God's love for our neighbors.
Let us pray. God, we thank you for angels in the Bible who teach us not just what your messengers say, but also what messengers of God are called to do. As we celebrate Christmas and move into a new year, use us as your angels who shine the radiant light of your healing hope for all the world to see and to celebrate. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Join us in thy will.
I'm so confused. I know I heard you loud and clear, so I followed through. Somehow I ended up here. I don't want to think, I may never understand, that my broken heart is a part of your plan. When I try to pray, all I got is hurt. Don't feel good, right? all joy, distracted by the noise, just trying to make sense of all your promises. Sometimes I gotta stop, remember that you're God, and I am not so.
Incredibly powerful song that summarizes this reading so well. So if you do nothing else this week in reflecting on today's reading and message, go back and listen to that song again and make it your own. I encourage you to do that and invite you to do so. A reading from Luke, the first chapter. God sent the angel Gabriel to a town in Galilee called Nazareth to visit a young woman named Mary who was engaged to a man named Joseph. Joseph was a descendant of King David's family, and Mary was a virgin. Gabriel appeared to Mary saying, "Greetings to you, favored one of God. The Lord your God is with you." Mary was bewildered by this greeting, and she wondered what the angel meant. Gabriel said to her, "There's no need to be afraid, Mary. You are held in God's loving embrace. Very soon you will conceive a child in your womb and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be a great leader. People will call him the Son of the Most High, and God will give him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob, and his kingdom will endure forever." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I have never been with a man?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of Almighty God will surround you. Therefore, the child you give birth to will be holy. He will be called Son of God. Furthermore, your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son. This is her 6th month of pregnancy, and it was thought she could not conceive a child at all. For nothing is impossible with God." With that, Mary replied, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. This story of Mary, more than any other character in the Christmas story, is about us. Mary was asked to throw her whole self, body and all, into the will of God to bear and to bring the love of God in Christ to the world. This is what Mary was asked to do, and it's exactly what we are asked to do today, to sell out for the sake of God's love being told, being shared, and made known in our world. So I want you to hear this story as our story, your story and mine. This is a story about discerning God's voice in the midst of all the voices that we hear, all the voices that call for our attention in life. This is a story about trusting God's voice and God's vision for what life is to be about, above and beyond all the other voices we may hear and all the other visions that may be offered for our lives. And we know, don't we, that there are powerful voices in our world that compete with God's voice. That is exactly Mary's dilemma. Sometimes if we've ever been abused or bullied by someone, or by a system or an institution, if we've ever been abused or bullied, we listen to the voice of that person or that entity, and we think it determines who we are. Sometimes if we're sick, and I mean really sick, or if we receive a scary diagnosis from a doctor, we listen to the voice of the illness instead of God's voice. We can let the illness define us and determine how we act and how we think. Sometimes when we experience loss, regardless of what that loss is, and especially the death of a loved one, we listen to the voice of grief. And it's okay, it's normal to acknowledge that voice of grief. But sometimes the voice of grief can convince us that we're never going to get over it and we'll never find a new normal again. Sometimes when I make a mistake or when I experience failure of some kind, maybe it's just not fulfilling what I had hoped to fulfill or achieve, or hurting someone that I did not want or intend to hurt, I listen to a voice that tries to convince me that I'm no good and that I'm a loser. In this familiar story leading up to Christmas, the angel Gabriel visits Mary. Mary, it seems, is a very common person and a very unimportant person in the grand scheme of things in her world 2,000 years ago. Based on all the clues in the New Testament, Mary is among the lower rungs of the socioeconomic ladder. The song she sings after this Bible story today, the song she sings called the Magnificat, is known as noting how she fits in to the scheme and the stratus and the various levels of humanity in her world. And then that note of how she wraps her newborn baby in scraps of cloth, again, a clue as to who Mary is and where she comes from. It's a clue, or multiple clues beyond that, to her insignificant status. The angel, speaking for God, realizes Mary may have a low opinion of herself, a jaded perspective on her own life and her own ability. Gabriel's greeting means he wants Mary to know that God knows her intimately and that God cares about her personally. We get the impression Mary could have easily doubted those things based on her reaction to Gabriel's greeting and due to her station in life. It would be normal and natural for her to doubt that she mattered at all, let alone to God, but to anyone. When Mary first hears this greeting, she's bewildered. She's perplexed. She's confused. She finds it hard to believe and wonders what it could possibly mean. So Gabriel, the mouthpiece of God in her life and ours, says it again in a different way. Mary, don't be afraid. In other words, what is Gabriel saying? You're not in trouble. You're not in trouble. You are held in God's loving embrace. You are in God's favor. One translation says, you have discovered that God favors you. You're realizing that God is with you, not against you. As if this was a new concept for Mary, that God would care about her at all and truly love her. And it makes sense. If Mary was among the lower rungs of society, what voices would she be hearing in her life, day in and day out? What would powerful voices say about her? What would be the prominent voices of her day? And what would they lead her to believe about herself? After assuring Mary for a second time of God's incredible love, that is her birthright and the world's birthright, Gabriel rolls out the plan of what God wants and needs Mary to do. Raise your child to be an instrument, a leader, so great that he will be named the one who saves God's people from their suffering. He will be named Yeshua, Jesus, the one who restores, the one who heals. Then Mary questions how this can be in light of her present circumstances. She moves, if you will, from, you want me? You want me? She moves from that question, now moves on to quite honestly and forthrightly ask, to do what? Because it seems impossible. What God is asking of Mary or of us seems impossible. It seems a monumental task for anyone. There's no way. But what makes it possible and what helps Mary move from the task being impossible and unthinkable to possible and within the realm of reality is one simple assurance from the angel visitor. Gabriel says, God will be with you. Gabriel says and tells Mary that not only does she matter to God, and not only is she held by God's loving arms, but that God will faithfully be present for her every step of the way. Literally, Gabriel says here, God's Spirit will live within you to work this out. That's our message, isn't it? God's Spirit will live within you to work this out. And the power of Almighty God, this incredible love that has no force to match it in the world, will be like a coat that you wear. It will be like God's powerful presence becomes a warm blanket that you wrap yourself in on a cold winter night, always at your disposal. So assured of God's love, assured of God's care, and assured of God's presence, Mary says yes. Mary says, yes, here I am, God's servant. Let it be with me according to God's will, according to your word. See, Mary realizes in this encounter with God's love, it isn't about her. Mary knows she has nothing special going on that makes her stand out or consider herself more capable or better than anyone else, capable of what God is asking. Mary knows it is only God in her midst and God within her that will make this possible at all. Again, it's definitely not because she thinks she's better than anyone else, more capable, or more qualified than anyone else. This brief encounter depicted in a conversation between the angel Gabriel and Mary captures the message of Christmas for each of us. God finds favor with us, no matter who we are, where we've been, what we've done, or what we've failed to do. God finds favor with us. God loves us. This gift is freely given, and it's undeserved, and it's for everyone. That'll be spoken again by the angel chorus visiting the shepherds, because they too didn't see themselves as worthy of God's time and attention. This gift means that there's nothing we can do to earn it. Simply and profoundly, we discover, oh my golly, this is who God is. God is love. God is compassion. And this gift of love gets dumped into our laps for us to figure out what we do with it. All we can do is accept and receive this gift and try to lay hold over a lifetime and every day what comes with it. The calling to share it, to give it away, to multiply it through our bodies, through our efforts, and through our yielding to God's will in our lives. The invitation is to embody this gift and let it live through us, because we realize this gift is bigger than anything else in the world, bigger and more powerful than any gift we've ever been given. And assured of this profound power of love, we offer ourselves to bear Christ and to bear this love for others for the sake of God's world, body, mind, soul, and heart. You see, the whole point of Christmas is exactly what Mary hears and how Mary responds before the baby Jesus is ever born. This story between Mary and God, depicted in the angel Gabriel, tells the story of what makes Christmas possible. And that, in and of itself, is overwhelming and powerful. This story between Mary and God is what makes Christmas possible. God says, regardless of your circumstances, and in spite of all the voices that we may hear and struggle to listen to, here's the reality and the truth. Here is my voice for you. You matter. You are loved. And God's got work for you and for me to do. And even though it often seems impossible, we can count on this. This power, this energy, this life that Jesus brought into the world, that Mary gave birth to, that makes our life meaningful. This power of love means that God is with us. And God will live out this calling through us every step of the way. My friends, that's the best gift we could ever be given. In Jesus' name, amen.
Join us in singing Sing, Mary, Sing.
that time in the service when we think about the offering that God can give to the world through us. How can we, in giving ourselves to God, allow God to continue to give to the world beyond us? I want to say thank you for supporting our annual blessing bag collection for our neighbors who deal with homelessness. Bags will be distributed to guests at Greensboro Urban Ministry on Christmas morning this Friday. We thank our Friday breakfast team for serving on Christmas Day and every Friday around the year. A reminder, too, of our annual Meals at the Manger food collection for those who struggle with food insecurity in our neighborhood and community, local community. It is winding down. Please bring food to share with local families by December 31st. We'll collect those through the end of the month for Greensboro Urban Ministry. Also, our Winter Hugs collection is taking place, and that goes on through February out at Entrance A. Hats, underwear, gloves, and socks are being collected to distribute to those who need them. And as always, thank you for your generosity so that we can continue to be blessing our neighbors with this gift of love in some very practical and tangible ways. God's work, our hands. Let's join our hearts and minds together as we pray. Join with me this morning. And we're going to conclude the prayers with a prayer written by and attributed to John Wesley, and it's called the Covenant Prayer. I envision this as very similar to Mary's covenant with Gabriel and with God in terms of allowing God to use her to bring this good news to bear. So we'll conclude the prayers with that. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we thank you for Mary's humility, and we thank you for Mary's courage and faith. Though she struggled, she was willing to trust you and trust your word above her own circumstances and among the many voices she might have heard. May we do the same. May we trust that we are held fully in love and that you promise to be present with us faithfully and daily. Lord of the journey, show us the way. God of peace, in this time of great division in your world and in for some of us in our own families, please give us this heart posture of Mary, who seemed to value the idea of listening carefully and also asking questions to fully understand before responding with her action. Let us be good listeners, O God, listeners to your voice and listeners to the voice of others, and maybe especially to those whose thoughts and ideas are different than our own. We pray, O God, that you would use our gifts and abilities to restore relationships and brokenness. Lord of the journey, show us the way. We lift up to you, O God, those whose needs are known to us as we especially think about those who have recently died. We pray for Diane Munyon and Ollie McKnight and their families. We pray that they may know that your love is stronger even than death. We pray that you will continue to walk with their families and friends and that you will use us to be a part of that good news in their lives. We lift up to you others whose names and needs are known to us. As we hold them in our hearts, so we hold them in yours. And so we pray for Matt and Christine, Rachel and Howard, for Evelyn, Catherine, Grace, Larry, B, Melissa, Rita, Arthur, Laura and Bob, Kim and Steve, Elaine, Janice, Carolyn and John, for Jan, for Jeannie, for Art, Will, and Jessica. Gracious God, hear us as we offer to you names of others that we wish to pray for this day, and we do so now, either silently or aloud. Help us, O God, to be your comfort, your healing presence in these people's lives. Lord of the journey, show us the way. So gracious God, as we enter this Christmas week, we hear your call to be like Mary today, to bear Christ and to bring Christ to others for the sake of your plan and for your wonderful world. In that spirit, O God, your spirit of love, we pray the words of the covenant prayer attributed to John Wesley. Loving and faithful God, I am no longer my own. I am yours. Use me the way you wish to. Rank me with whom you desire. Use me for doing or use me for suffering. Let me be employed for you or laid aside for you. Praised and honored for you. Or brought low and humbled for you. Let me be full or let me be empty. Let me have all things or let me have nothing. I freely and wholeheartedly yield all things to your pleasure and your discretion. And now, amazing and wonderful God, creator, teacher, and companion, you are mine and I am yours. So be it. May this covenant which we make on earth today be celebrated and ratified in heaven forever. Lord of the journey, show us the way. All these things we pray, trusting this message of Gabriel, God's message to us, that you, O God, are with us. And now we pray together what Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So we take a moment now to celebrate this gift of God with us and God for us, as we receive a special meal, a meal we call Holy Communion, a time to commune with God and with each other in a very intimate way and know that love is larger than any of us. Join with me as we share these words together now. In a feed trough in Bethlehem, at a table in Greensboro,
God is with us.
As a man dying on a cross in Jerusalem, as a hungry child, a jobless woman, or a homeless man among our neighbors,
God is with us.
In our worship and our praise, in our singing and our praying, in the beauty of the earth, in a simple shared meal of bread and wine,
God shows up to love us, to set us free, and to offer a new path for our journey.
The night before he died, Jesus gathered with his closest friends and followers for a meal. He thanked God for bread and wine, then shared it with everyone, saying, "Here I am, loving you, blessing you, showing you the way. Eat and drink and remember, I am always with you." Whenever we share this meal, we celebrate the promise of Emmanuel. God is with us, gifting us with abundant life.
A gift meant to bless the world. Thanks be to God.
So take a moment to receive this gift and this promise and hear these words given in love for you. May that give strength to your journey. Join with me for a blessing and the last song. Go into this fragile and fulfilling existence knowing you are loved. As we question God's calling in our lives to embody the love of Christ, as we consider the fears we will face in taking a stand for God's justice, as we express our confusion by crying out with honest hearts, "How can this be?" May we be inspired by Mary's humility and guided by Mary's confident trust in God. Let us help one another respond in faith. Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word.
Come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, till the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou wisdom from on high, who ordest all things mightily, to us the path of knowledge show, and teach us in a ways to go. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel, shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, again I say rejoice, for unto us is born the Savior of the world. Take heart, O weary soul, take heart, for help is on its way.
For the gift of your presence. So go with Christ and go as Christ to love and serve God's world.
Thanks be to God.
Merry Christmas.